Well, then without further ado, today's talk is going to be by Allison Kohler. You see her title there. This is work she just told me she did as an undergraduate student at Northland College in Wisconsin. And she's currently a master's student with Dr. Morrison. So I'm going to turn it over to you.
All right, thank you. Welcome, everybody, and thank you guys so much for coming presentation about a natural phenomenon, hot pink, glow-in-the-dark, flying squirrels. If you're in the market for a new favorite animal, you've definitely come to the right spot. This is a pretty accurate, good presentation for Friday the 13th, something a little mysterious. So, glow-in-the-dark is not the correct scientific term that I should be using, but it is fluorescent. And fluorescence, there you go. Okay, some people may be more familiar with bioluminescence, which happens when a living creature creates and emits its own light, like fireflies or bioluminescent algae. But fluorescence is different, and it happens when something absorbs one wavelength, a shorter wavelength, which is UV, and then it reflects it into a longer wavelength, which is visible light. And ultraviolet wavelengths are actually invisible to the human eye. Come on in. But a black light acts as a translator, and it allows us to see UV in the visible spectrum through the process of fluorescence, which is how the pictures of the fluorescent flowers are taken. And biological fluorescence is actually fairly common in the natural world, especially in the lower life forms, lower trophic levels. It's seen a lot in plants and corals, insects, fish, and a little bit in some reptiles and amphibians, a handful of birds, and even a couple mammals as well. And now flying squirrels can be added to the list as one of the first mammals discovered to fluoresce. And all of these creatures use fluorescence for a different purpose. Some of them for a sexual or mating display, like some birds, like those in particular. There is one experiment where they put sunscreen over the fluorescent parts of the male birds, and the females didn't want anything to do with them after that. So they had deducted that it was a mating display that birds use the fluorescence for. But some fish blend into their ultraviolet saturated coral environments and use it as camouflage or an anti-predator trait. But today is about flying squirrels, so I wanted to tell you guys where you can find them. They are nocturnal, and they can be found anywhere from Alaska all the way down to Honduras, and a little bit in Texas, but not too much, the southern flying squirrel. So there are three species of North American flying squirrel. There's the northern, the southern, and the Humboldt flying squirrel, which is just in a little cluster on the East Coast. And the bold areas that I highlighted in the map are the regions where we have specimens from in this particular study. So this project started when one of my undergraduate professors made a really interesting discovery. He was out in the middle of the night in his pajamas with a black light in his hand in his backyard looking at different plants and lichens and mosses that fluoresce under black light. He's a forestry professor, so this was something that really intrigued him. And it just so happened that the stars aligned perfectly and a flying squirrel went right through the beam of his blacklight. And so of course he came to school the next day, flew through the classroom door, and he said, "There's glowing hot pink flying squirrels in my backyard. Class is canceled, we must investigate." Just like that. And of course nobody believed him. Everybody thought he was a bit crazy. And me being a senior at the time with a lot of extra time on my hands, he kind of handed it over to me and said, "You know, you're an animal person. I just know trees. You have to go explore this. Huge." And so we eventually got some photo video evidence, and this isn't altered at all. This is exactly what it looks like holding a black light up to a flying squirrel. It is that vibrant. And so at this point everybody's heads were turned. Nobody knew what to think. And so a small team formed at Northland College consisting of myself and three of my professors so that we could investigate. And we started by going to the Science Museum of Minnesota, and then we went to the Chicago Field Museum to expand our sample size. and we looked at 109 flying squirrel specimens and 26 other specimens of three different species that represented the control group. And those were the red, gray, and fox squirrels, which are diurnal, as opposed to the glaucomus, the nocturnal one. And we also had five additional opportunistic observations of living wild flying squirrels that we saw during co-occurring but non-related projects that we just added to the sample as well. And so we were at the museums. We photographed each specimen under natural light, which is just like a light bulb in a room. And then we did the same thing under 395 nanometers UV light using an iLumen 800 LED handheld black light. And here are some of the photos that we got. And we also had a yellow lens over the camera, or yellow filter over the camera lens. And the reason for that was that black light, it gives off this residual blue wavelength that human eyes and the camera lens picked up. So by adding that yellow filter, it was able to mitigate that blue and just leave this pink color, which is what we were looking for. So you could see the change in the pink that was happening. We photographed each specimen on their dorsal surface and their ventral surface. And as you can see here in this one in particular, the dorsal surface was quite vibrant. But for almost all of them, the dorsal surface was not vibrant at all, and sometimes there was no fluorescence at all on their dorsal surface, but the ventral surface was almost always completely covered, and you could see that really vibrant pink. And in addition to that, some even had these really clear patterns, like you can see in this one here, her mammaries are clearly highlighted. And I also want to mention that there were no chemicals or anything in the treatment process of these specimens. They may have had some water washed on them to clean them, but there was nothing else that could be resulting in this fluorescence that we're seeing that was done in the process. So we divided each specimen into four different ventral body regions, which were the head and neck, the body, the tail, and the patagia, which are the gliding membranes. And each of the four observers ranked each individual in their ventral body region from 0 being no fluorescence to 5 being really vibrant fluorescence. And we also ranked each region, or we estimated the percent cover of fluorescence in each of those regions as well. And we found out that all three species of North American flying squirrel fluoresce hot pink. And also not one of the control species fluoresce this pink color at all. And so the pink diagram on the left here shows the mean fluorescence scores for all of the flying squirrels that we saw. And it shows that the body was the most vibrantly fluorescent, and the head and neck was the least vibrant. And then the black and white diagram shows the standard deviation of that, showing that the tail was the most consistent and the patagia was the least consistent. There was the most variance in that. And similarly, we have the percent cover, this time showing that the tail was the most covered in terms of surface area, and the head and neck were the least covered. And we have the same results for the standard deviation, showing that the tail was the most consistent and the patagia was the least. And I think the reason for that is because the tail was easily seen. We could easily kind of, in our mind, divide it and estimate. But the patagia was sometimes tucked into the animal and sometimes all the way spread out. So that was kind of hard to visually estimate just by using the naked eye. So as you can see, some specimens were more vibrant than others and some were more covered in fluorescence. We used general linear models to explore the patterns of fluorescence, but we weren't able to find any significant correlations. We looked at the relationship of fluorescence to species, sex, seasonality, which is the month that it was collected, or the season that it was collected, the latitude of collection, and several others, but none of these factors were able to describe the variation in fluorescence that we are seeing. In other words, it's completely random at this point. And of course, it's possible that with more data, some trends may start to appear. So, why is this happening? What does it mean? And perhaps most importantly, is it ecologically significant? And the short answer is, we just don't know yet. But we can speculate. So after expanding our sample outside of Bayfield County, Wisconsin, we could conclude that this was not the result of a handful of flying squirrels living next to a fluorescent paint factory, for example, which we considered. But it could be due to some other exogenous factor, like consumption of fluorescent lichen, and it may not really mean anything to the squirrels at all. But it seems unlikely that some environmental factor would span such species, seasons, decades, habitat types, like all these other variables. So for that reason, we are suggesting that this is an intrinsic trait and that perhaps it's ecologically significant. We came up with four different hypotheses to explain this phenomena, although they are not necessarily mutually exclusive. So it could be multiple or even all of them happening, or something completely different that we haven't thought of yet. So the first is that it relates to the flying squirrel's unique crepuscular nocturnal light environment. They are the only New World squirrel that is active during this time of night, and it just so happens to be the one time the crepuscular setting that is most proportionately abundant in UV wavelengths compared to any other time of day or night. In addition to that, the flying squirrels have transparent eye lenses that are capable of transmitting all the UV wavelengths, as opposed to the diurnal squirrels that and humans that filter UV to protect our eyes. So they let through UV wavelengths through their eyes, but we have no idea whether their brains are processing that information or not. So in other words, we have no idea if they can, or their predators or the prey can see this fluorescence at all. Now, related to that, this part is hard to explain, kind of hard to wrap your head around. We don't know how they see it, if at all, and we obviously see it as this vibrant pink color, but perhaps they're not seeing it like that, but maybe more of a shade or a really dark color. So it's possible that either the flying squirrels or the predator or the prey are seeing it as a really dark color, essentially cloaking their lighter surface on their underside, making it appear dark, more similar to their back color. So can you see how that may help them blend into their nighttime environment if they're covering up their light surface? So that's a possibility, but we just have no idea yet. And the second relates to their winter environment. The flying squirrels don't hibernate, so they're active year-round, walking through the snow. And even though the amount of total sunlight decreases during the winter months, amount of UVB radiation, which is a kind of ultraviolet wavelength, it increases and perhaps even doubles in the winter compared to other months. In addition to that, the snow reflects UV, which could be a further indicator of how significant this winter setting may be to the flying squirrels, to help with maybe navigation or warmth or something. And the third is that it could relate to intraspecific communication, or the squirrels communicating with conspecifics, other flying squirrels. They could be showing off a bright, vibrant underside as they glide from tree to tree and then conceal it as they latch onto trees or curl up in a nest at night. So maybe they're showing off. It could be a mating display. But we're kind of leaning away from that because it was both males and females that seemingly do this equally. So for that reason, we're kind of thinking it's probably not a mating display, but it may be. And the last one that we have, this one's really interesting. So a lot of owls, which are the squirrel's predators, have this exact same trait. And just the fact that flying squirrels live in the same areas and are active during the same times of night and have the same pink color and the same general patterns across their body as the owls do is intriguing, to say the least. It could be a form of Bayesian mimicry, where the squirrels are trying to disguise themselves to look like the owls to avoid predation. Pretty crazy. Similarly, they could be trying to avoid predation simply by blending into their ultraviolet saturated environments like the fish do. We know a lot of the lichens and mosses fluoresce, so maybe the squirrels are trying to avoid predation in that way by using it as a camouflage. This is discovery science. It's one of the first mammals ever discovered to fluoresce, and it shows just how much is hiding right in front of us. more that we can learn about these animals, the more that we can understand them and help conserve them and potentially apply this information to a wide variety of other species in the future. And there are also potentially some human benefits to this as well. For example, right now there is a fluorescent protein found in coral that was used to greatly advance the speed of the cancer detection process. So I don't want to get too far ahead of myself here, but the point is, who knows what implications this could have in the future in a variety of different fields. But in the end, I just hope that this research allows people to take just a moment to pause in the middle of our crazy, busy days to simply wonder in awe at the natural world around us. There's so much still out there waiting to be discovered, and maybe right in our own backyards. And sometimes all it takes is looking at things in a slightly different light. I want to make sure there's a lot of time for questions and discussion. I love talking about this with people. Everybody always has different ideas of what it could be, and we've arranged our hypotheses so many different times. So if any of you have any ideas or anything to add to this, or any questions, I would love to open it up for discussion. Yeah.
So what's known about the owl's and its ability to perceive evening?
That's kind of what I'm going to be digging into for my PhD research, is kind of zooming out and looking at the whole nocturnal realm and which creatures can see it, which have this property. And I know that, I believe all birds, so humans have the three different color cones in our eyes, red, blue, and green, I think are the three. And birds have a completely fourth one, which we call the UV color. So UV is actually a color. And you can imagine all the different combinations, the exponential amount of additional colors that we could see if we added a whole new color into that. So for that reason, I think science has concluded that the birds can see, and I don't know if all of them do, but I know a lot of them, especially raptors. There's been some studies where raptors have followed these weird lines across fields, and they figured out that they were following the UV trails that rodents were leaving. So we do know that a lot of birds can see UV. We don't know about this particular wavelength, but hopefully we will be looking into that and finding some answers. Yeah.
So you talked about the patterns that you noticed on the squirrels and everything. Did you or your professors have any more thoughts as to what the pattern could or anything that matters?
It's everything is complete speculation right now. It was really interesting. You could clearly see like the mammaries were highlighted on the females, which may have something to do with the young trying to find it. That contrast is how the young can find where to eat and get food. So that's possible. But it's kind of weird too, because then all the males fluoresce as well. So I don't know, maybe it's just a trait that all squirrels have, but the females have sort of evolved it to help their young. We have no idea, but we do see that a lot of females had that pattern in particular.
Yeah. I was wondering if anybody's studied the chromatophores or the cells that are allowing the UV light to be emitted. Did anybody look more
specifically? Like in the fur?
Yeah.
We are doing that right now, and I don't really have anything to say about that yet because we're looking into it. Chemistry is not really my field, but they're doing a lot of, they're trying to basically extract it and identify what the compound actually is. And we think that it is porphyrin, which is it Gunther's disease? There's some disease in humans where they actually accumulate this compound and it makes human bones fluoresce hot pink. So we think that it's the same thing. And for whatever reason, the squirrels are maybe having it build up in them, and it clearly doesn't seem to be detrimental to their lifespan or anything.
It'd be interesting to compare that with what's in the owls to see if they're different
right.
In terms of their...
it seems like it would be the same thing, but there hasn't really been any research on the owls either. The only paper that I think you really found, where I got like the picture, work, how they age owls. The younger ones have really vibrant fluorescence on their underside, and then as they shed the feathers and grow new ones, they're less vibrant. So it's it was a tool in sort of a wildlife techniques paper, not looking into anything else regarding the fluorescence. So it's all fair game. Yeah.
Just to follow up on that question, is it just the hair or is it also the skin?
That's a good question. And from my experience, it seems to be the fur. I could kind of part the fur, and it didn't seem to be coming from their skin. But it seems like it would have to originate like in their skin somewhere for them to maybe excrete it onto the fur. But it also seems like it's actually within the fur, because we tried crushing it up to see if it would dissolve into a solution, and it didn't. It remained inside the fur. So it seems like it might be some structural component. But also, I have not looked at any living ones that close. It was just, you know, like a flying squirrel going by. So I don't know if that's different from if they're living and when they are dead.
Because the fur is functionally dead as well. It's just keratin.
Yeah.
Be interesting to see exactly where
it is,
in the shaft.
Definitely. So to be explored.
But it's really cool. So.
Yeah, it's really interesting. Yes. We looked at the sub-adults and the adults, and it was just completely random between those two groups, as of now.
Are those red and green fox squirrels the closest relatives of Wakami?
That's a really good question. I am not sure. I don't know about that. There are other flying squirrels in other countries, so I would maybe imagine that they're more related to them.
I'm an expert.
There's a squirrel biologist in here.
The flying squirrels in other countries are in different genera as well.
Okay.
I'm not sure the answer to it either, but I think mostly the North American stuff is closely related.
Yeah. I think just the fact that we had one access to them and two their additional side note is that the fox squirrel, there was one paper, and this is the closest thing that we found related to this whole thing, is that fox squirrels' fossils fluoresce bright pink as well. So that was used in people looking at fossils trying to identify, is this a fox squirrel or a gray squirrel or a red squirrel? They found out that using black light, the fox squirrel's bones fluoresce in the fossils. So there's another little
predation or something like that. There have been studies out of groups in the state that are looking at like the lateral stripes on kangaroo rats around their hips and legs, and those fluoresce as well. I'm not sure if it's hot pink or another color, but this might be pretty common across a lot of rodents, maybe.
It could be. I'd be curious to see what color that was. And just from my experience, when we were in the museum basements, night at the museum, just everything, all the different specimens. So that's kind of what made this stand out in particular compared to everything else. But yeah, it could definitely be more, I think it is more common. Yeah.
Have you all also discussed that there may be no function at all?
Yeah, it's definitely possible that it could mean nothing at all. And it could be the result of like eating fluorescent lichen, for example. It's always a possibility. And I think that it'll take further investigation for sure, but also perhaps behavioral studies to see if they can see it. I think that's kind of the next question, to figure out if the flying squirrels can see it or the owls or someone can see it. So, yeah.
What about sugar gliders? Is it ahead of function? Do you think they'd be concerned with those two? Birds and those two?
Yeah, you know, I asked somebody who had one as a pet, and they said that it didn't, but who knows? That was one. But yeah, I'm really curious to look at, you know, other countries of flying squirrel and see if it carries through, or if it's just like a North American thing right here, because then that would be a clue that maybe it's something right here, but yeah, don't know yet.
Do the owls, do they have fluorescence on top of their body, or is it just on the underside of the wing?
It's a little bit on top, like it's basically the same general pattern as the flying squirrel. It's a little bit everywhere, and some of them are more vibrant. Especially the video of the living one was a lot more vibrant. But generally, like if you just look at it, it's completely on their underside, and especially in the fluffy down feathers of the owls. Yeah.
Did you look at any other species like along the trophic system, from you know the base of the lichen, you said, fluoresce, all the way up to the top predator owl, fluoresce? Did you look at any intermediate species?
No, we didn't. Okay. And yeah, that's, I mean, that's a good point too. Kind of the same thing with the lichen. They could just be eating something that fluoresces. Because it's known that a lot of insects and a lot of plants fluoresce as well. They're omnivorous, so they try to eat some of everything. Yeah, I mean, it's definitely possible that they're eating something and it's sort of bioaccumulating this compound in them and it's working its way out. But that, it seems unlikely that that would be the case because of these interesting patterns that we're seeing.
All right. Well, thank you very much.